Hi guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
So this is another story from the Paladin DM that also goes by Lord Althory. If you like his work, you should check out his Subscribestar to support him directly, or check out his YouTube channel linked to down below. And with that out of the way, let's get into the story.
Be me, Paladin, Lord of Roads and Hyperlanzalak, Beaker's Door the Subterranean, Andri of the Forest Trails, Peregrine of Unwalked Roads, Senkit of the Jungle Paths, Eort of the Proud Highways, and Julian the Sojourner from the Crossroads. Wandering Paladins of Order Undivided. They did not find themselves wandering much over the next few weeks, though. Instead, day by day, they returned to the depths of the Eladrine mines to reforge them, and also the slaves kept in bondage within. As Kazdor improved the mine itself with the aid of workers, who surprised the Eladrine guards with their cooperation, Eort and the others trained his Alpha Legion in the depths, where no light reached. There in the shadows, they drew out their bags of holding, and unloaded them. Spears, swords, light armor, shields, arrows, and bows. A small armory smuggled into enemy territory for this exact purpose. However, even with the whole party's inventory, they had barely enough to equip a sentry in a population of 2,000. As his compatriots worked with the old guard of the Legion to train the younger up in basic combat and discipline, Julian pondered the problem of supplies. He had never expected to make a professional army out of slaves overnight, though they progressed swifter than he could have hoped. Even still, the low supply worried him greatly. With such a skewed ratio of fighters, they would be vulnerable to assault while retreating to Hearthfire. If the enemy came upon them with any substantial force, they would have to run. If the enemy brought cavalry, even light scouts, it would force them into a potentially unwinnable battle. He needed cavalry of his own, or at the very least more weapons and armor. As he paced the darkest tunnels, he heard the woman's voice once more. "Strapped for logistics?" she asked from an unseen view. Julian immediately took notice and looked around. He was alone, down here in the dark. This certainly wasn't a dream either. "I have legions and weapons aplenty, many very much like the blade on your back. Of that I certainly have no doubt," Julian responded carefully. "Bast, do you know who this is?" he whispered to the devil cat perched invisibly on his shoulder. "Yes, and she can hear you," Bast responded. "Indeed. Who do you think gave you the spell to loan her out from me, HM? The voice spoke again. "I have always provided you with what you need only ask. And pay quite the price. I know too well how devils work. My family never had the pleasure of serving an archduchess though, but even you play by the same rules, isn't that right, Zariel?" Julian answered, finally giving word to his suspicions. "Well done, my young arcanist, well done," the lady of the first answered him. "Though I have less of a price than you might expect, I do not expect you to give me your soul, yet. Merely, I want you to deliver a message. Out with it, I know you're not telling me everything. I'm not some religious zealot who's going to rebuke you, so let's deal honestly. I'm probably going to hell already anyways," Julian said, crossing his arms with a scowl. "You're one of the few mortals on this plane who has heard of my realignment of priorities. I wish for you to inform Zarathustra's daughter of it. The news will provide an opportunity to bring her properly under my wing and reunite his little family. Do this, and all the weapons, magical weapons, and armor your rebellion and budding empire could need are yours." Julian heard this and was silent for a long moment. "No," he said at last. "Senkit and I are not friends by any stretch of the imagination, and I hold no affection for the heavens, but I will keep my peace on that matter. I made my choice, but I will not make that for anyone else. My offer stands," Zariel said as her presence retreated. "That attitude will make filling your quotas quite the hassle when all is said and done, my young diabolist. It shall be interesting to see if you keep it." Julian heard her go, and sighed a lump forming in his throat. She'll find out sooner or later, it's inevitable. He sighed. But I won't be the one. I'm evil, but I'm not a monster. I don't understand you sometimes, Julie Bast told him, smirking inwardly at the Arsimert's blush at hearing his childhood nickname. You know her faith is worthless, and you don't have any real attachment to her. A fallen paladin could be a useful ally in our ambitions. If you think that her faith is worthless, you haven't been paying attention. She'd kill herself rather than fall. Now come on, we need to find a new solution. He said, heading even deeper into the mine to think. As he descended, he caught the smell of rot, and pulled back. Something had died down this tunnel. He peered ahead, trying to find the source so he could burn it away. Nobody. He crept along, morbidly curious. Then his foot brushed up against something. It was a root-like tendril, creeping out of the wall. A blight tendril. Julian immediately went on alert, unleashing vengeful spirit, the flames illuminating this darkest corner of the mine. There were a few tendrils, growing out of nothing, and shadows of tendrils even where none lay. The veil between the world here was thin, practically fraying. He did a double take as he thought he saw the form of the hobgoblin walk by, but he was still alone. Well, this could be a problem. Bast hissed, hair all standing on end, tail ramrod straight in the air. Or an opportunity. Come on, we need to find Peregrine. Soon Peregrine and the rest of the paladins, Barker's door, were assembled before the weak point. What exactly do you want me to do? Peregrine asked carefully. The veil here is weak. A sufficient surge of necrotic energy could open it. Wait, hold a second. Senkit said, looking at Julian like he was slightly more insane than usual. You want to open a hole into the realm of death? Why? Because if it's because you want to stop living, I have a solution to that that doesn't involve getting us all eaten by the undead. Sorry, but you'll have to burn me for heresy another day, no offense, Andre. Julian said. The Inquisitor shrugged in response. A surge from Peregrine would only open it for a brief while before it closes again. In other words, it's a door we can open and shut as we please. You still haven't explained why we'd open it in the first place. Senkit continued to prod. Simple. It's an undetectable route to transport in more supplies from the Abbey, which rather conveniently happens to have a gate into the Shadowfell in its basement, Julian said. Welp. That's less cracked an explanation than I was expecting, but if we're going in and out between here and the why, we don't just evacuate all the slaves though there? She asked, arms crossed. A small team can get in and out without detection. Moving 2,000 people though that will attract everything within a dozen leagues to come and try to take a bite. Not to mention the small problem of the Nightwalker, which could probably wipe out the entire legion by itself. Julian explained. There's another problem. We can't just vanish for a few days without arousing suspicions. None of our mounts are fast enough to make the trip in time. Andre pointed out. Actually, that's not entirely true. Eort said, with a meaningful look at Julian, who nodded. Belisarius and Bucephalus are fast enough to make the trip in a day and a night. We've been holding slower for you all to keep up. You're kidding me. They're horses, but they're not that fast. Senkit said with a frown. No. Julian corrected her. They're nightmares, and they are that fast. There was a moment of stunned silence before Senkit spoke. Nightmares, of course. Between the Devil Cat, your Hellblade, and everything else, it only makes sense that you'd have yet another devil on your payroll. I'm starting to wonder whose side you're on, Angel. I'm no angel, and never pretended to be one. Julian responded coolly. And I'm on the same side I always have been on, mine. I'll take what power I can get my job done. Morality plays be damned. At this rate they're hardly the only thing. Sen muttered back. I'll have to deal with your insufferable ass in addition to all the other torments of hell it seems. Well, considering I don't pay the gods their precious lip service, I figure as much too. Now, are we going to continue standing around complaining about purity, or are we going to get to work? Julian said with a slight huff. Senkit glared at him in the sort of way only those who harshly judge themselves, and from their all of creation, for their damnable unrighteousnesses can, but said nothing. Peregrine sighed. Jules, you are the only person I've ever met who I would describe as players about their impending damnation. What am I going to do with you? Keep trying to get me to change my ways in vain because you recognize I'm a force for good even though I'm both a heretical blasphemer and a blasphemous heretic? Pretty much. Figured, now let's get on with this week's very bad, but possibly very good idea. Peregrine sighed, and pressed his hands to the thin veil. Calling upon his power, he feed dark power into it, and the veil came apart in his hands, like gossamer silk before a fire hydrant. A gateway of darkness opened before the paladins, and a cold wind blew past them, chilling them to the bone. Julian ignited vengeful spirit once more, and stepped through. The others soon followed and found themselves once again under the starless void. The gate had opened above ground, despite how buried the entrance was on the mortal side. They were surrounded by a dead, flat plain. In the distance they could see skeletons of trees, but all around was an ashen waste. The ground was covered with a fine layer of grey dust, and each footstep was muffled in it, throwing up fine particles. The air was completely still, though they all felt a chill running through their souls as if the cold north wind bore down upon them. The air was as stale as a tomb, and carried with it the taste of a mausoleum and the faint smell of rot. Bucephalus and Belisarius soon arrived, their true forms now revealed. The proud black stallion Julian so frequently rode had a coat indistinguishable from the void above them. His mane and tail were scarlet fire, and his eyes were an unholy indigo. Belisarius was an entirely different kind of nightmare. The babe was now bereft of skin, and the dull red of underlying muscle replaced the warm red fur. His white face was now a grinning skull, with pinpricks of light in the empty eye sockets. Despite their somewhat horrifying appearance, the mounts seemed as friendly as ever. Bucephalus nuzzled Julian affectionately, and Belisarius bumped his head into Eort's chest, looking to see if perhaps the hobgoblin had an apple core for him. Eort raised his hands up in a shrug, as he didn't have any. The monstrous whore seemed to pout slightly. The rest of the paladins looked generally horrified at this display, with Andri slowly beginning to wonder if you could poison a divine mount. Before they had much time to act, they heard a loud whinny call out across the dead silence. The mounts answered, and soon they heard the muted thunder of approaching hooves. A herd of nightmares thundered across the umbral plains towards the party, riding around them and eyeing them with far too much intelligence for any equine. They were a varied lot, most the standard black stallion with flaming highlights. There were also skinless ones like Belisarius, and two other varieties. One variety appeared malnourished, with baggy skin that showed their ribs. The other new horror had a mane of serpents and breath like a plague ward. Its skin was rotted as if with leprosy, and it seemed to radiate an aura of decay. Mortis, Fames, Pestilens, and Eresian. Julian said, not with horror, but a sort of scientific curiosity and wonder. All four major breeds in one herd. Exceedingly rare, the thin barrier in these lands must attract them. I wasn't aware they came in multiple flavors. Senkit answered uncomfortably. Yes, Eortsis Amortis, they're generally not seen very often but they've been used by more than a few Jhin and mercenary bands. Bucephalus is an Eresian, they're the ones you probably know, since the Hells breed them as war horses. You don't usually see Fames, though they make remarkably good work horses, providing you don't need them for farming. As for Pestilens, I've only ever seen one before, and it was in service to a hag I made a delivery to. Julian said, his excitement over the monsters making him slightly oblivious to his ally's discomfort. Jules, I appreciate the nerd out as much as the next fellow, but can you focus on explaining how we don't get trampled by them or something? Peregrine mentioned as the nightmares were somewhat uncomfortably close. I imagine they want to chat. Julian said calmly. Apologies for my poor accent, Sen, my infernal is a bit rusty. His mood seemed far too cheery for someone surrounded by nightmares. A pleasure to see you all. I take it our little breach attracted your attention? He asked. His infernal was rather rough and accented, but still solid. Bonded. One particularly large Eresian answered him. You are in the wrong place, and you have brought meat. Leave it, and you may depart. What are they saying? Andri asked Senkit. The horses want to eat us. Sen responded, taking her mace in one hand. Great. Andri said, taking a grip on her bow. You know who I am, don't you? Julian asked the Umbral Equine. You are Julian, son of Baneth, bonded of Pasiphalis. That is why you may yet escape. I am the War Master of Order, and I have need of cavalry. Explain this title's relevance. I plan to fight a war or several. Join me, and you'll have all the flesh you can eat. We do not wish to become bonded, and we have not tasted elf flesh in a very long time. The stallion responded. A trial run then, considering I am currently preparing for a battle against Eladrine. Julian answered calmly, and the herd's ears collectively pricked forwards. Simply ride with a few in this battle, and if you wish to join me thereafter, so be it. If not, you'll still eat your fill. The leader stared down the Arsima, who stared back with equal intensity. We have a bargain. I am Shetun, my herd will ride with you. The herd disbanded around them, and Julian turned back with a grin. I think we've solved our cavalry problem and our supply problem all at once. These elves won't know what hit them. Be me, Paladin, creator of more totalitarian societies than is probably healthy. Because Dor the Avenger, Eort the Treacherous, Julian the Conqueror, Andri of the Ancients, Peregrine the Redeemer, and Senkit the Devoted, warriors of Order undivided. With the new supply route through the Shadowfell now open, the armament of the Hobgoblin speeds up significantly. However, even with the aid of the dwarves in the Abbey, they are still woefully short on supplies. Only half the Legion has weapons, and only a quarter armor. Still, it is proceeding well. Furthermore, the pact with the Nightmares is proving quite useful. The Old Guard, particularly any of the Equites, have begun training on horseback once more, with Julian and Eort leading the advice on how to fight alongside a Nightmare. In the meantime, Kazdor continues his work on improving the mine. He increases ventilation, cooling the deeper tunnels. He improves the elevator to run on a two-lift pulley system, where getting on one lift raises the other. To complement this, he alters the schedule so that the hobgoblins shift around more frequently. This has the added benefit of ensuring the whole legion is able to receive training. Andri spends what time she can educating those with a talent for archery, though most of the legion is better suited to throwing weapons, namely their javelins which Eort calls Billa. However, she and Peregrine are kept busy keeping Lady Ashbury and Mittalk busy respectively. Andri continues to use her cold, ruthless face when interacting with Ashbury. The two fit together like a pair of nails in an Iron Maiden. Peregrine and Mittalk discuss their many travels and discuss various techniques they've learned and developed along the way. These talks make Peregrine increasingly uneasy, as he realizes just how skilled the brawny elf is with that halberd of his. On the night before their rebellion, Andri and Ashbury go for a walk in her gardens. The two women practically glow in the moonlight reflecting off their pale hair and skin. If one two walked by, they might surmise a pair of spirits were passing through, fair and terrible as the ladies of the moon themselves. Andri, I must ask after how you keep yourself so fit in your old age, I certainly could use the advice. Ashbury says after a while, though she seems perfectly fit to a human's eyes. Andri sees slightly differently. Faint wrinkles, and almost human slowness touch the old elf, the grace of youth is gone. I'm not nearly as ancient as I appear, I am only 230 years old. Andri says, slightly embarrassed. My hair has always been pale, and while the eyes are a recent development, the circumstances behind them were unusual to say the least. Really now, such a shame. You're fair enough to be the envy of any lass your age, and the only thing in the eyes of men any age with common sense. Considering my companion Senkit exists, I somehow doubt that. I said with common sense. Any fool knows better than to go cavorting with Hellspawn. She's beautiful all right, but that's the kind of beauty that you find on a serpent. To lure fools in to destroy them. You speak as someone who doesn't know that particular abyss. Bah, my point stands. Regardless of how she acts, that's how she looks. If you looked your age, then they'd never give her a second glance. I've never really given it much thought. You should, particularly if you keep walking in the world of mortals. Men will never take into account your skills, your bravery, or your strength. Beauty, though, that is a weapon that can be turned against them sharper than any sword. Though I suppose I shouldn't give you any advice with how Mitilk looks at you already. Andri's skin crawled slightly at the discussion, and she sought to turn the topic elsewhere. Yes, him, when did the two of you meet? H.M., I would say around 50 years or so ago. We met in Elvacaran, when he had just traveled out of the Far East. The Far East, you say? Andri said, growing increasingly concerned due to the time mentioned. Yes, he said he came from a land that had fallen to war and his previous master had passed away. Liu Bu, I think the name was, some human name or another. That got Andri's attention. Perhaps Lady Ashbury didn't recognize the name, but Andri did after having heard some of those stories from Peregrine. If Liu Bu actually existed, and Mitilk had trained under him, well, that might be even worse than what had previously been her worst fears. As Andri and Peregrine set out with the company back towards the mine, she slowed to speak with him. Peregrine, you've been speaking with Mitilk a great deal. What do you think of him? Peregrine frowned. I can't get a good picture of the man himself. He seems to me a bit of a savant, wholly dedicated to his craft. Unfortunately, that craft is fighting, and while we haven't sparred, I suspect he's damned good, and probably about as strong as if I had to guess. Lady Ashbury seems to think he came from the Far East. Is there any chance that he might have trained under that Liu Bu you told about in your stories? Peregrine frowned. I suppose it's not impossible, but that would make him one of the most well-preserved elves I've ever met. What do you mean? Depending on who you ask, that story took place over 1,000 years ago, though he might be from another plane like Julian, one where it happened only recently. Or he's not an elf. Andri murmured darkly. The only things I know that are that old are dragons, angels, and fiends, and I've never known a dragon that's subservient to a mortal or an angel that served a slaver. So that means he's a liar or a fiend. What kind would he be though? You and Julian are the demonologists in this party, I just tell the stories. H.M. The elf a fiend? I suppose it's not impossible. He'd be a devil, but the only devils I know that are fond of halberds would be foot soldiers and middle management. If what Peregrine says about his skill with a weapon are true, he'd be a rather unusual one. Julian said when Andri mentioned it to him. How unusual. Devils all exist to serve a specific purpose, from the lowest Lemur to Asmodeus himself, everything in the Hells has a specific role. That's why while you might have a dozen different personalities in Pit Fiends, they all have the same powers, with some exceptions for their higher-ups. They're there to do the same job. Julian explained. So, what kind of devil would need to be a master halberd fighter? Not certain, which means one of two things. Either he's a liar, or he's one of the few high enough up to be close to unique, in which case his presence over something as relatively banal as a silver mine makes no sense. I think he's just a skilled warrior and bullshitter. What if he weren't a devil? A Yugloth would have taken the Enterprise over already, and a demon wouldn't serve as quietly as he does. Even a skilled arcanist can't keep those things from snarling at the end of their leash. Unless it wants to be there, but that would mean a particularly subtle kind of demon. Such as one associated with Loloth, which are universally female. With one notable exception. Andri finished. And if it is that particular exception? No, it can't be. That exception is long gone. You never said he died, Julian mentioned. He has to have died. It was an ancient silver dragon that brought the cavern down on him, he's got to be dead. And if he isn't, he wouldn't be waiting around as a bodyguard, but if he did, we'd be better off slitting our own throats. Andri said with a grim look. So it can't be him. Soon, the paladins arrived at the mine. The guards welcomed them as familiar and friendly faces. They didn't notice that Yort was absent, hidden under a cloak of invisibility. They walked towards the improved elevator, giving a nod and a hidden signal to a hobgoblin slave. The slave returned the nod and hastened towards the barracks. They rode down the elevator to see their newly forged legion standing there awaiting them. "It is time," Eort said, and the hobgoblins saluted their legate. Peregrine and Julian passed into the dark and opened the gate. "It is time," Julian said to Shetan, and the black stallion reared up and whinnied, and the Aresians and Mortuzians of his herd passed from shadow into the physical world. The equites mounted. After a little while, the first cohort was assembled. Around them was the Mortuzian section of the equites. The Aresians had already scattered to predetermined positions. "Citizens, hobgoblins, lend me your ears," Eort declared. "There is little time for speeches, and it is no time for them anyways. Today the hobgoblin nation rises once more. Today, we break the chains of our oppressors. Today the legions rise again. Or liberator, liberari the manatus. Or liberator, liberari the manatus." His legion answered him, and as much of the first cohort as could fit boarded the lift with the paladins. Behind them, the second half awaited the next lift. A signal was sent, and the Aresians entered the ethereal plane. As the lift rose towards the sunlight, several of the legionaries squinted into its brilliance. Still, their eyes adjusted in time. In the shadows of the lift, the Mortuzians followed, silent and unseen. The guards upon the lift were strengthened, and about a dozen of them stood on the platform, that it might be protected better, all this by Kazdor's orders. As they heard the lift approaching, one particularly observant and cautious guard decided to look down the lift. He was stunned to see a lift filled with heavily armored legionaries. He began to shout a warning, but Undri spotted him first. Two silver arrows streaked upwards and slammed him back, dropping him. "It's combat music time. Mortuzians. Forwards," Eort declared, and the nightmares flew past to seize the lift platform. The remaining guards were caught by total surprise as the skinless monsters rose from the dark like devils out of the pits of hell. They panicked and grabbed for their bows, but too late. The equites took their vengeance as they drove their spears into the guards, and the nightmares' hooves crashed into them. The Eladrine fell, pierced, crushed, and rotted from dark powers. A panic went up around the camp as the guards realized their danger. Many ran for the edge of the pit the mineshaft lay in, drawing their bows out. The nightmares retreated back into the pit as arrows began to fly. Then the lift finally arrived. "Testudo," Eort called, and the legionaries locked their shields, some raising them above their heads, others to the sides. They created an invincible tortoise shell of treated wood, rendering the oncoming arrow fire next to useless. The formation marched for the path used to ferry ore in and out of the hole around the pit. It was a narrow walkway perfectly sized for this formation, just as Kazdor had planned it. They marched surely upwards and outwards, with the Eort and Senkit at their head. Several of those guards who had not yet reached either the pit, the walls, or the barracks, came up to the pit. When they saw that their arrow fire was ineffective, several grouped up and charged down the path towards the formation. They had the higher ground, but the hobgoblins had the paladins. Seeing that the frontal charge was ineffective, several others forsook their bows and charged at the sides of the formation. However, they slipped on the fine sand and dust that had built up on the sides of the pit. This too was an invention of Kazdor, who had subtly increased the slope of the pit and covered it in a slick dust. Several of the Eladrine went tumbling into the pit, but still others kept their footing and moved to attack the sides. This is what the rest of the paladins were in reserve for. Kazdor and Julian took flight, the former carrying Peregrine. Kaz threw Peregrine up into the line of surrounding archers, while he descended upon the left flank. Julian took the right, his blazing blade cleaving elves in twain as Undri provided cover fire. As the Testudo summited the pit and came out onto the flat ground, they separated, breaking the formation in two as they charged the other archers. Peregrine had already done decent work turning them into mincemeat, and the charge broke them, sending them scattering. As they fled, the legionaries flung their pillar into their backs to ensure they could not regroup. However, with the Testudo broken, the legionaries came under fire from the archers on the walls. Two hobgoblins went down to lucky shots in the first volley. Then the rest of Julian's plan went into effect. Rising from the earth like vengeful ghosts, the Eresian cavalry charged out of the ethereal plane and into the material one, running up the walls and into the arches. Once more, the diabolical cavalry charge and the fury of the Aquites broke the guard. Several leapt from the walls to try to save themselves as the flying horses ran along the walls causing havoc. The paladins hurled the bodies of the dead around the platform back onto the lift, causing it to fall and the other to rise, bringing up reinforcements. The battle seemed all but won, when the paladins heard a shout from atop the barracks. "Stop, stop this now and get back down in your pit," Anilidrine called from the barracks roof. In one hand he held a knife, and in the other, a young hobgoblin who struggled against him. "Throw down your weapons or I'll slit her throat and toss her carcass of this roof. We have the rest of them inside too." The battle slowed, but there wasn't exactly a lot of Anilidrine left to not kill. The paladins and hobgoblins looked at one another uneasily. Julian walked forwards, sending in Bast under invisibility to check to see if it were true. "All right, come now, no need for such a thing," the charismatic war master said as he approached, weapon put away, but not his gauntlet. "Let us parley." "Why should I parley with a bunch of savages?" "Get back now or we'll send you the severed heads of everyone in this barracks," he shouted back. "And we're the savages," Eort muttered quietly. "Come now, you must understand the situation is not quite as one-sided as you say it is," Julian said. "Bast, hurry up, I'm not sure how long I can keep him talking. I mean, they're still trying to break down the barricades you had them set up, it looks like they caught a few and killed them before they got in." "Acceptable casualties. For one thing, if you kill your hostages, there is nothing you have left to bargain for your lives with." "Don't test me, Angel. I'll do it," the Eladrine said, his voice cracking as he saw Julian's gaze. "If you do not let her go in the next 6 seconds," Julian said, dropping all pretense of diplomacy, his voice dripping with cold fury. "I will see every last one of your comrades slaughtered like cattle in front of you and grant you a slow and miserable death." "You're bluffing. I know you, paladin." "Wrong. Dead wrong," Julian answered, and snapped his fingers. A bolt of lightning ripped out of the heavens and struck both the guard and the child he was holding. Both fell back onto the roof, smoldering. "Though I was lying. You won't get to see them die. Kill them all," Julian ordered coldly, and then he drew his blade and charged. The others stood stunned by what Julian had just done, and then they charged after him. Julian blasted open the barracks with a torrent of electricity and fell upon the surviving Eladrine like a man possessed. His furious smites shattered blades, and he left a trail of burning, mangled bodies behind him. The paladins and hobgoblins followed, and cut them down to a man. Once that was done, Julian raced back outside and soared upwards as fast as his wings and legs could carry him. Eort followed after him, and found him crouched upon the roof, the child in his arms. Eort took one look at the charred little body, and went berserk. He charged at the Asmir and tackled him back, laying into him with fist, bolt, and pummel. He broke Julian's proud nose again with a punch that sent golden ichor spraying out against the roof, grabbed his raven hair and yanked it back. Then he beat him in the face over and over with the pommel of his sword before Kazdor grabbed his wrist and held him back. "The child isn't dead," Julian said as he got back up. "I don't blame you though. I do put on quite the convincing show," he said to Eort, who slowed as he saw the welts and tears in the War Master's face. Julian moved on, seemingly not caring, as he went back to trying to heal the child's wounds. "I held back," was all he would say, whether that was regarding the child, or Eort, none could say. "Be me, Paladin, master of tyrants petty and grand." Because Dor Glamdring, Julian Tyran, Eorto Protos, Senkit Zarathustra, Andri Silverthorn, and Peregrine Horsa Rider, paladins of order undivided. With the last of the prison camp's guards driven off or slain, the paladins and the newly reborn Alpha Legion regroup. The remainder of those down in the mines are brought up into the sunlight, and the remaining weapons and armor are distributed. Even with the aid of the nightmares and the supply route through the Shadowfell, the Legion is at only half strength, The Paladin's army consists of 1,000 heavy infantry, perhaps 100 archers, and 40 nightmare cavalry. Despite their better equipment, there were still casualties in this first battle. 91 hobgoblins were slain, mostly those in the outer sections of the barracks, who were butchered by the Eladrine as they tried to take hostages. There is not time enough to bury them, so instead a legion cuts wood from the nearby forest and lays it out in a great pyre. The hobgoblins are laid atop it, and each of the paladins offers a prayer in turn. May these warriors rest, knowing their people are free and shall avenge them. Kazdor offers. May they find the peace in death that life denied them. Blesses Peregrine. Let their spirits be freer than their bodies could ever dream. Says Undri. Let what sins they committed be absolved by their sacrifice. Requests Senkit. And then it comes to Eort, and also to Julian. Neither man knows quite what to say, for one has rejected his people's god, and the other the gods altogether. Julian speaks first. Hear me, O deities. If any of you are devoted to the cause of us mortals, and to any who care to listen, know that these are good men. If you indeed love justice, and reward righteousness, do so, no matter whom comes to your door. Julian says at last. Amen, Eort echoes. If you indeed see us, receive those who fought against tyranny, and do not deliver them into the arms of yet another tyrant. Thus, spoke the paladins, and Kazdor lit the pyre. The Alpha Legion saluted their fallen as the dragonfire consumed them. Ut non obliviska, they swore. They shall not forget. As for the Eladrine dead, the bargain with Shetan was upheld. They were cast into the pit, down into the darkness. There the nightmares devoured them, and the sound of gnashing teeth rose from the shadows. With the dead attended to, the paladins turned their attention to making more horse fodder while reducing the size of the pyres they would yet have to build. Or in other words, they began to talk strategy. The camp is ours for now, but we are going to need to get moving back towards Hearthfire sooner rather than later. Eort said. It's only a matter of time before a counter-strike falls. I would nee be so sure. Kaz countered. The lass has nee much in the way of territory, and therefore few men swarm to her. A good point, we probably can outdo her in terms of raw manpower, but think about it. She's managed to hold on to an incredibly valuable silver mine against any aggressors. If she didn't have some way of fending off invaders, she wouldn't hold the mine. Undri countered. If I had to guess, with the amount of money she's bound to have, she's bought herself more than a few allies in nearby provinces. I imagine she'll call those in fairly swiftly. Peregrine notes. Even still, she'd need some kind of strength besides the allies to keep her grip. If she hasn't got manpower, I'd guess magic, or mercenaries. Senkit said. Probably a bit of both. The odds of her being or having access to a mage strong enough to fend off an invasion are slim. Fireballs can do good work, but only so much. If you want to fight an army with just magic, you'd need spells of the 7th tier minimum, and that's as rare as diamonds in pig shit. Julian responded. At least on this plane anyways. Blood whores then. Kazdor growled. Wonderful. Hang on, let's not leave the magic angle yet. Senkit advised. What about creating an army with magic, like necromancy, or conjuring one? Necromancy-wise, it takes some rather absurd work to raise a literal army of the dead, Julian answered. They can do it in places like they because they're a magocracy and of a slightly smaller army of midges. You can do it with certain rituals, though I'm afraid I don't know them, but those aren't something you can do quickly. It can take months, years even. As for conjuring something to fight us, he continued. That is much faster, but far more costly. Ugloths would be the first thing I think of, but if you want to keep your soul it can cost an arm and a leg, literally. Devils occasionally hire out their armies, and if she's crazy enough she could probably call on some demons fairly quickly. However, that brings with it the small risk of them being practically uncontrollable. Not necessarily. Undri noted. The drow use conjured demons all the time. The drow have interbred with demons to the point where they're probably no more than a few steps away from growing horns, hooves, and turning red, no offense Senkit. Julian countered. They get along with demons because they're basically cousins at this point. So back to the mercenaries. Peregrine said, steering the conversation away from fiends before Senkyub decided Julian needed his nose broken for a third time. Right. Yort said. She'd want something able to respond fairly quickly, but also something able to either outmaneuver or stand up to our heavy infantry, plus something to deal with the nightmares. Andri, you're the local expert on elvish forces, what can we expect? Julian asked. Andri frowned for a moment as she considered. I doubt we'll be dealing with any heavy infantry other than ours, the closest thing I've ever seen to that were executioners, and those are one of the Lakedham's projects. Axemen in heavy armor we put together to deal with monsters like trolls or ogres. That's the exception though. It's far more likely we're looking at skirmishers, archers and light infantry. Fast, and very deadly on the offense, but that formation you used seemed quite effective against arrow fire. Yort nodded. We developed it specifically to deal with elf archers. There's some rather serious drawbacks though. It's slow, and not even remotely maneuverable. If we don't mix in more mobile elements it can be flanked very easily. Hence the nightmares. Andri said, and the Yort nodded. As for how to deal with those, that's the sort of thing the Inquisition would be called in to deal with. It's hardly natural cavalry. Let's assume she doesn't have an Inquisitor on hand, what then? Yort said for the sake of argument. Spearmen, I presume? Andri nodded. Depending on what kind, it could be anything from a relatively standard spear wall formation to something as insane as dragoons. I just don't know what's in the area. She could certainly afford dragoons too. Julian muttered. If those show up it's going to be a serious problem. We don't have the ranged fire or the magic to deal with them, and while we can probably bog them down in infantry, the cost would be very high. If there are dragoons, we can at least assume there won't be too many. Yort says. Though if there are any, it's going to be up to us to deal with them. What about cavalry? Senkyub suggested. That's fast enough to catch us and maneuverable enough to run circles around our infantry. If there's enough, they might be able to drive off our cavalry and then just continually cycle charge us. Elves don't generally produce heavy cavalry like human knights. Andri responds. We do have light cavalry and horse archers though. Horse archers, great. Julian grumbles. On the upside if it's that, our cavalry is more than fast enough to catch them and hardy enough to crush them. We've essentially got a bunch of extremely quick shot cavalry with these nightmares. So, we're probably looking at some substantial light cave, heavy archer presence, and probably spear infantry to boot. Yort listed off. All lightly armored but highly maneuverable. In contrast we have plenty of heavy infantry, a few archers, and a very few heavy cave. Wherever they hit us, they'll want to bombard us and force us to come to them, Julian said, his fingers twitching as his eyes flickered over a dozen different phantom battlefields. Probably into an area where the cavalry can engage us from the flanks if they have it ideally. Spearmen guarding the archers, and possibly hidden in the wings to engage our cavalry if we try to pursue theirs. He went quiet for a few minutes as he ran battles through his head, analyzing and fighting the battle from both sides, like a chess master watching an untouched board. Andri, he said. Give me the maps you've taken of the nearby area. Andri grinned, she'd kept doing that since they started this journey, even before they reached the abbey, and now it was coming into play. She got it out. Draw a circle showing everything within 3 days' march. She won't let us get any further away than that without hitting us with something, just to slow us down while her allies gather enough troops to crush us. Julian ordered, and she did so. Julian pointed to 3 different locations on the map. Here, here, and here. We march for each one in turn and set up our defenses there. If we get past this, then we break for the abbey with all speed, because that means she's waiting for her allies, and that means an overwhelming force will be coming our way. One we need walls to hold off. Hang on a second. Senkit said, pointing towards the point on the map where the portal was. Why not just break for the portal? If we destroy that, no forces come through at all. Simple. If we go there, we risk having to fight a battle with an enemy force if she moves faster than expected. Julian answered. If we get there and her mercenaries are already rallied, that means we have to be the ones to attack, or we have to fight in the area around the portal, which is not a good battlefield for our troops. However, if we break the army, a small team could take advantage of the chaos to attack the portal and destroy it after the mercenaries retreat. Makes sense, Eort says. And so, the paladins prepared their armies, and they moved out. On the first day, they set up camp and made ready with their backs to a hill, between the remains of two buildings so that they could neither be surrounded nor flanked. However, no attack came. On the second day, they traveled further. They moved slower than expected, for the foraging had not been as successful and so the men were hungry. However, with stubborn discipline they preserved, and rested atop a hill surrounded by forests. As their foragers went out, they came back reporting that they heard the sound of marching. So Eort and his Mortuarians flew out, silent as death. They found the enemy encamped nearby, and knew that they were being tracked. Eort watched closely, and saw how the men spoke with familiarity to Mittelk, for they knew him well. As Julian had suspected, the Lady Ashbury had a company of mercenaries nearby. From what he observed, it consisted primarily of spearmen and archers, although they did have a sizable cavalry contingent. The exact numbers were unknown to him, but he suspected that they totaled about 2,000 men. Knowing this, he retreated, and reported all that he knew to Julian. The next day, the Alpha Legion deployed for battle on top of the hill, and the Elven army sent to take them back deployed at its base. The cavalry of both sides remained in reserve. Julian looked down upon the enemy arrayed before him with a grim stare. He was outnumbered 2-1, with relatively green troops. He held a superior position, but possessed neither great numbers of archers or cavalry, while his foe possessed both in great numbers. As he watched from the front of his formations, the enemy began to march forwards. Julian had drawn his forces into three lines, and while they stood shoulder to shoulder, each line was further divided into three segments, the center and the two flanks. Those in the third line had no armor, for there was not enough, but carried shields. The third line also held what archers they had. Julian and the Eort were in the front and center. Senkit held the left, and Gazdor and Peregrin held the right. Hidden to the right, the whole of the cavalry waited in the ethereal and shadow planes. The enemy had drawn up in a standard formation. The spearmen held the front, with the archers behind them. They had placed further spearmen on the flanks to prevent a cavalry charge from striking the archers. Behind them, the cavalry waited in reserve. They were all in one unusually thick line, so as to envelop the rebels. This meant from the moment the lines impacted, the hobgoblins would be at risk of being flanked, or even surrounded. However, the elves were so confident in this that they had no lines in reserve. Julian grinned. This was not what he had expected, it was far better. The elves would regret underestimating them. All right then, you bastards. Eort swore beside him. Round 2.
No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video.
Be me, Paladin, witness to more death that is probably healthy. Because Dor the Skulltaker, Andre the Poisoner, Peregrin the Blades Master, Senkit the Morning Star, Eort the Backstabber, and Julian the Talon. Heroes, technically speaking, of order undivided. They stood, each in their place in the formations as the Elven army marched upon them and their hobgoblin allies. Senkit alone on the right, Eort and Julian in the center, Castor and Peregrin on the left. Andre remained towards the rear in the third line with the archers, scanning the field. She carefully noted the position of any commanders or captains among the cohorts of elves coming upon them, and placed a careful finger to her arrow. "Swift death to my enemies," she whispered as she bound magic into it. She raised her bow. She could easily fire accurately from this range, particularly with the advantage the higher ground gave her. The same could not be said for her cohort though, and she did not wish to risk them squandering ammunition. They were going to need every arrow they could muster. As she scanned, she noticed one conspicuous absence. Mitluk wasn't anywhere to be found, neither among the infantry, nor the archers, nor even the cavalry. Very curious. In any case, she would have little time to worry about it. The enemy was almost in range. Julian signaled to the center, then to the left. She would first fire upon the commanders in the center, then once battle was joined and her archers could no longer fire into the melee for risk of hitting their allies, they would focus on supporting the left flank, as it was likely to be encircled without the aid of the cavalry hidden to the right. Andri raised her bow high and shouted the signal to her cohort. "Swift death to all who oppose us," she declared, and fired. The first arrow streaked across the battle and struck an elven sergeant in his striped shoulder. Purple vines erupted from the wound and bound him. It didn't kill him, but it did make him stand out. In a moment, the rest of the cohort's fire fell on him and the men nearby. Andri smiled, and repeated the process on the next unit over. In the first moments of the battle, two enemy sergeants on the front, and 33 other spearmen lay dead. The elves had not expected the enemy to have any archers at all, and this mistake cost them. To their credit, they reacted quickly and moved their formation to a looser grouping. This may have reduced the effectiveness of the archer fire, but it left their leaders all the more exposed. Julian watched carefully as the wider formations approached his lines. It might be possible to deliver a serious blow if he deployed his cavalry now, but that would also leave them vulnerable to the archers or a countercharge by the elven cavalry. Not yet. The elven spearmen approached uncomfortably quickly. Andri and her archers would get at best two more volleys before they hit. It would have to be enough. On the upside, that would mean his front line wouldn't eat much in the way of fire. Though as he watched the small storm cloud of arrows rise from the elven archers and fall towards them, much was very relative. "Testudo," Eort called to his men, and the whole army transformed into tortoises. The deadly rain fell upon an umbrella of reinforced wood. There were a few gaps and a few cries as arrows struck home, but the barrage was rendered largely ineffective. A few arrows flew directly at Julian, and he calmly sidestepped one and smashed the other out of the air with his talon contemptuously. Fortunately, thanks to the hill, only the first line was in range. The second and third lines remained clear. Andri answered the storm with a second, smaller volley of her own. Another two commanders fell dead in the center. Then, the lines met, and there was no more time to shoot. Elven spears met hobgoblin shields as the two masses of infantry met in a thunder of clashing iron and wood. On the right, the charge was blunted as Peregrin and Kazdor held the line. Whirling axes and blazing short swords gave pause to even the boldest elves. Kazdor held the front while Peregrin held the furthest right. His skill and the psychological effects his flaming swords and fell smites left upon the enemy kept the wider elvish line from flanking them on the right. The same could not be said as much for the left. Senkit was an indomitable force on the front. No spear could touch her, and she broke through men like paper when they drew near. The commander of the left infantry met her, elven saber against infernal mace. Back and forth they went for a moment, sparks flying with every exchange until Senkit swept his guard aside with her shield and crushed his skull under the thorns of her morning star. Despite this, her flank began to retreat, not from losses, but to keep pace with the enemy on their furthest left. The swifter elven light infantry attempted to circle around them, so as to gain even higher ground and encircle them. The left's retreat began to trigger similar, smaller pulls back along the entire line up to the right, creating a diagonal line. Even still, the elves probably would have been able to envelop the left altogether. Save for the actions of the third line and their archers, who punished the encirclement attempt with a storm of fire. An entire elven unit was wiped out nearly to a man and broke, countering the encirclement. Units from the second line moved forwards in a countercharge to relieve the endangered left. Andrei noted this and sent a message, ordering the right with elements of the second line to the center, and the center to the left to ensure it would hold. Even still, the enemy commander smelled weakness on the left, and the cavalry deployed, circling around to try to charge the archers and then hit the center from behind. As they moved, Julian smiled. There was no way they would risk their valuable cavalry against his right. Khazdor was there, and his ferocity and power was well known. He was also very easy to spot, and thus also made an excellent warning sign. The line as a whole stalled for the next few moments, as their heavily armored hobgoblin front line held, despite its strange bent. Khazdor and Peregrin continued to slaughter any flanking attempt on the right, and with the deployment of the second line and focus of the archers on the left, it too was able to avoid retreating any further. Meanwhile, Andrei fired silver arrow after silver arrow into the throat of any commander she could find. Still, Mittal did not show himself. Then the elvish cavalry arrived, and the earlier redeployment of the second line proved fortuitous. As they lacked the heavy armor of the front, they were able to deploy in a long, thin shield wall between the cavalry and the archers. The elven cavalry commander scoffed at the defenses, and continued the charge. The thin second line hurled the first of their pillar into the coming charge, killing several, then took their second small javelin and attempted to hold back the coming blow. The short spears were no pikes or lances though, and while they did bring down quite a few horsemen, the line broke as the cavalry smashed into it. The cavalry was slowed though, and that was precisely the point. Andrei took aim and fired a thunderous arrow into the chest of the elven cavalry commander, throwing him from his steed with a roar that the whole battlefield could hear. The sound spooked the horses, and then the whole of the third line opened fire. The survivors of the second line turned and threw their pillar and drew their swords. Even some of the rearward elements of the front turned and threw their spears. The crossfire slaughtered the light cavalry, and the spooking horses fled, the charge broken. Not without cost through. Fully a third of the second line was either dead or rooting, and the left would not hold for much longer. Senkit heroically stood before her formations, covered in the blood of her enemies and more than a bit of her own. Even she was beginning to grow weary though, and the green soldiers around her were only moments from breaking themselves. On the right, the more veteran elements of the army still held on, even as the enemy massed to drive a wedge between them and the center and split the army. They were fighting on two sides, and without the aid of the archers. There was only so much they could do. To make matters even worse, the elven archers had finally drawn close enough to fire upon the third line. Andrei herself was wounded as an arrow struck her in the leg. Her soldiers dragged her under a testudo they formed, but even still the sheer amount of arrows were causing serious casualties. The battle was dangerously close to defeat, with the enemy closing in on all sides. If the paladins were to seize victory, they would have to act immediately. Julian realized this, but even still he was smiling. His army might be mere inches from rooting around him, but the enemy had played directly into his hands. He sent the signal to Bast, and therefore to Shetun, who she was with. Then, he ignited his wings and soared above the battlefield. Ordo Utim Victor. He roared, and Khazdor heard him, and knew the signal. Spreading his own wings, he soared to above the pocket between the center and the right and blasted it. Dozens perished in dragonfire, and the pocket broke. Julian fell like lightning into the newly cleared space. With boots planted in the ashes of his enemies, he turned down the center, with the enemy so nicely lined up, and let loose the fury of his talon. The very front of the elven line vanished in a brilliant flare of crimson lighting. The soldiers of the Alpha Legion saw it and knew what to do. As the elves staggered back from the heat and light, it faded as swiftly as it had come. What followed was a storm of billet that slaughtered the unprepared elves. With their commanders too dead to rally them, the center broke. Then the Dark Hussars arrived, charging out of the Shadow Fell and Ethereal Plains onto the battlefield. The Nightmares and their equites finally arrived, soaring over the enemy, they descended onto the archers in the center. As they attacked, the remaining light infantry in the center charged to meet them. The elven archers were caught between hobgoblin swords and nightmare hooves. Against such power, the archers stood no hope. They were butchered in their dozens, and broke, splitting the elvish army almost entirely in half. In a single move, the battle had shifted from one of near defeat to a stunning victory. With the arrow fire no longer pounding down upon them, the third line again opened fire onto the retreating archers and cut many down. The former front line split, Eort taking one half, Julian taking the other, and they fell upon the enemy flanks. The elves who had encircled them almost from the beginning now found themselves on the receiving end. On the right, Eort and Kazdor wreaked terrible vengeance upon their foes. The old guard had been defeated by the Eladrine before, but not this time. No quarter was given, and only thanks to the actions of Peregrine was an orgy of bloodshed prevented. He stood between the rampaging hobgoblins and the retreating Eladrine and said unto them, "There has been enough bloodshed today. See, the enemy is broken. Any who would continue this violence shall take it up with me." And the hobgoblins did not pursue, for they had seen his skill with the blade, and respected him greatly because of it. The ever troublesome left was another story. For while the commander had been struck down in the beginning of the battle, a new one had been raised up from among the sergeants. And while he was fair of face, silver of tongue, and much beloved by the men, he was not the most observant of leaders. He continued to press the attack, even as the former center bent to fall upon him and his men. He continued to shout for them to charge and slay the enemy, until he saw Julian, in all his terrible glory. The War Master tore through two men with great sweeps of his flaming sword, and then ripped out the heart of a third with his talon. The new commander quailed, for the War Master had come, and none could stand before him. The left did not survive the day, for Undri and her cohort came down the hill and fired upon them as they fled. Volley upon volley struck fleeing backs, until they had no more arrows. The Inquisitor's face was cold, for she was much accustomed to slaying her own people. At the end of the day, the hobgoblins were victorious. The dead were gathered, and 241 had perished, mostly on the left. As for the Eladrine, 1412 were found dead upon the bloody-stained side of that hill. The hobgoblins had been outnumbered 2-1, and yet had reaped almost 7-1. Such was the might and majesty of order. With the enemy broken, the paladins had a chance to ensure that this war would be won. If the portal was destroyed, then the oncoming elvish army would be unable to breach into the mortal plane and make war upon the Ordanic Union. As such, the party separated once more. Eort continued southwards with his legion to the abbey, and the original five returned to the ancient city to destroy the gate. As they travelled, they could see the trail of the fleeing remnants of the elvish mercenary army. As they travelled, a single question continued to dog them. Mitluk had not been among the dead, nor had they found him anywhere in the army. Where then did he go? The paladins sensed there was something sinister taking place beyond their knowledge, but still they persisted. After another day of swift travel, they once more reached the gate. The tall stone arch with the glowing energy between it hung over them. The sun was beginning to set, and the air was deathly still. Even as Julian and Undri debated how best to bring it down, they could not shake the feeling that something was terribly wrong. Then the gate rippled, as someone or something stepped through. The paladins formed up as they had so many times before, expecting perhaps a scouting party. What came through was just one man. Mitalk. The brawny elf stepped through the gate alone, smiling at the assembled paladins as if he had been expecting them. "Very well done. Very well done, all of you. Undri, my dear, I see you're still every bit as ruthless as I made you, maybe even a bit more." "I don't know you," Undri said, though there was a tremor in her voice as she looked at the smirking elf's amethyst eyes. "Of course you do, and Julian, I must say that little tactical turnaround was quite the treat to watch. You really deserve your title, War Master," he said. "You know, you're useful enough that if you join me, I might let you live." "Sorry, I don't serve. Particularly not dead men," Julian said, and snapped his fingers. All six gems went dark and a lightning bolt tore out of the sky directly on top of the halberdier. Mhilk caught it. The elf simply raised his hand and caught the lightning bolt. He held the energy in his hand for a moment and smiled. "Canned magic, how quaint," he said, and he tossed it aside. A spray of electricity the size of the gateway fanned out behind him. "And they call you an arcanist." Julian was stunned. That magic had been boosted to the 9th tier, and he had tossed it aside like a scrap of paper. Undri went cold as ice. "You believe it's me now, don't you, my young apprentice?" Mitiluk asked her as he began to approach. "Run. Run, you fools, run," Undri stammered out. Her voice was barely a whimper and she spoke in Elvish, too terrified to even speak properly. "Oh, my dear, you should have told them that long ago. I know I taught you to be more observant than that," the elf said, and as he spoke his form shifted like rolling slime. First his features changed, to be a far older and more handsome elven man, with stark black hair and noble features. His armor changed too, becoming a baroque set of midnight black plate. His halberd became one fit for a king, gleaming with potent magic. "You always did have that flaw though," he muttered, and Undri dropped her bow, backing away even as her friends interposed themselves. "You could only see what you wanted to see." He kept getting closer, and the paladins braced themselves. Every one of their instincts was screaming at them to run, but they held firm. "You wanted me to be your noble teacher, and then you wanted me to be dead," he said as his skin turned black as coal, and his hair white as frost. "I am afraid those first two wishes shall remain ungranted. Perhaps you'll get the third?" Ilaktam asked his former student mockingly. "Be me, Paladin, master of dungeons and the vilest monsters within, though this is one of my viler creations." Be Julian, dumbstruck at how the drow standing before him tossed aside his most powerful attack like a spitball. Because Dor, glowing with rage for all the grudges this monster has inflicted on Undri. Be Peregrine, aware that he stands before a being of pure wickedness, a prince of darkness and spawn of the abyss. Be Senkit, silently lifting up the battle before her and her friend in prayer. Be Yort, well aware of the danger a drow poses, but already plotting how to beat him. Be Undri, paralyzed with fear because she knows this man, and knows this is a fight they have no chance of winning. Be Ilaktam, grandson of Lolth, former Grand Inquisitor, bane of Otria Karan, corrupter of the Fae, prophet and preacher of slavery, master of demons, archmagos, and doom of the Inquisition. Ilaktam threw his head back and laughed, long and hard as he saw the effect he had on the paladins arrayed before him. "I trust you've all heard of me then?" "Good, good," he purred. His voice was like silk wrapped around razor wire, smooth and sharp. "I, though nee enough to think ye were so petty as to track Undri down this far," Kurz answered with a snarl. "No, no, no. As fun as she was to play with, I had no idea or intention of encountering her here. To be honest, I thought I'd done enough to her that she'd never step foot outside her house, or what was left of it, again. I suppose you were a little stronger than I thought then," he responded coolly. "No, and quite frankly you aren't even a bonus, just an annoyance, particularly with your little emancipation effort, and when you started building a kingdom of your own, well, that just ruined everything," he said with a bit of a snarl building into his voice. "You paladins, you really just stick your feet in with no idea of what's going on around you, don't you? You kill Klani and wipe out the Imperial line, you get into a fight with orcs and get chased off, battered and broken. You find my little scheme and tear it all to ribbons with nary a thought. How obnoxiously inconsiderate of all of you," he growled, a watery, slimy snarl that betrayed what he really was under that facade of a man. He sighed. "At least I proved the point well enough. 45 years isn't much, but that was all it took, all I needed to draw out the truth of these so-called children of Karelin. You saw it, of course, didn't you, Goblin? They were using slaves as well as any Underdark city without a care in the world. Imagine what I might have been able to do given a century or two." He hung his head back as he started into some twisted nightmare of a dream. "It could have been glorious, thousands upon thousands of Eladrine drawn down to Grandmother Lolth, a poisoned wound in the side of Lartian and his ilk, Everything I should have done after I gutted old King Anarion if I hadn't let my excitement and mother's bloodlust get out of hand. But no. He said with such raw hatred that the paladins all took one step back. The mad demigod's charismatic voice and aura of power had kept them from attacking during his monologue, and now they braced themselves for battle, far less certain of their chances. Even if I were to kill you, they're talking now, and the slaves have heard now. There will be no end of troubles now. Rebellions now. Abolitionists now. Maybe even a civil war now. There could be elven heroes springing up now. Hobgoblin filth thinking they could be free now. All because of you now. So, I do believe I will kill you now. He said, his voice becoming more frenzied, unstable, and high-pitched as it built into a crescendo of insanity. Then he stopped, wiped the foam that had built from the corner of his mouth, and fixed Andrian a stare that froze her solid. Except you. You will not die for years yet, assuming I don't get carried away. He said, licking his lips and drawing his halberd. Kazdor was the first to snap out of it, and he charged, throwing himself between Elaithm and Undri. Axe met halberd and neither moved. His second axe came in and began to force it down. Kazdor was strong, the strongest a mortal can become without magical aid, but Elaithm was far, far beyond mortal. Fortunately, Kazdor was also 2 feet taller, and had the better leverage. He pushed the halberd down as the two men strained against one another. Are you dead yet? He snarled and swung his axe out and forwards. The silver blade hit the drow's magical armor and bit into it. The sound of an anvil being struck rang out across the courtyard, and Elaithm's torso exploded into goo. The goo then bent backwards and hung upright. The shapeshifter laughed as his amorphous body stretched outwards, practically unharmed. Yet is the key word. He said mockingly, and he pointed a finger towards Kazdor. Julian recognized the motion and shouted a warning, but too late. Black vines erupted out of Kazdor's chest and all across his body as a tidal wave of necrotic power washed over him. He seemed to age a decade in seconds, his body withering, his scales growing duller, his bones weaker. He doubled over, vomiting a black, tar-like substance. Then Elaithm came down, and drove his halberd through Kaz's armor between his wings, though his back, and out his front. The dragonborn fell. Elaithm shifted his body back to its usual proportions, then stepped over Kazdor's unconscious body, ripping the halberd out as he went. Peregrine moved forwards to stop him, deflecting the drow's strike as he came in. Elaithm grinned as he saw the killer's glint in the halfling's eyes. Peregrine moved like a blur, cutting the fingers from one of the drow's hands as he leapt upward. He planted his sword directly in the drow's throat, then ripped it out with a surge of dark energy. He landed to see Elaithm, head half severed and the gap writing with dark vines, grinning at him. Wonderful killer's instinct. If I bled, I'd be quite dead at the moment. He said, pulling out one of the vines and tossing it to the ground, but I'm afraid that you're good enough to actually be a threat, so I won't be engaging you in melee any longer. Peregrine tensed his legs to dodge an attack, but that did him little good as gravity reversed and he fell upwards. His world spun as he felt himself flung into the sky, and then plummeted back into the cold stone with a splat. No amount of swordsmanship or armor could protect him from that. Elaithm's smile faded slightly, however, when a phalanx sword erupted from his chest. Eord had plunged the magic weapon in up to the hilt while the drow was distracted. You're about a centimeter away from my heart, but good attempt. Elaithm told the legate as he whirled, blocking Eord's next swing. What in the abyss made you think poison would work on me though? He asked curiously. Eort held his own against the pressure of the halberd, so Elaithm turned his lower body into a snake. He wrapped around the hobgoblin's ankles, crushing them and hurled him into the pillar of reversed gravity. The drow sighed in disappointment as Eort landed next to Peregrine rather than on top of him. I need to work on my aim. He muttered. He turned as he almost absent-mindedly blocked the glowing mace of Senkit from splitting open his head like a watermelon. She slammed her shield into him, but it was about as much use as hitting a brick wall. She swung again and he batted it away, practically toying with her. Julian moved quickly past the two of them, stabilizing Kazdor and closing the hole in his chest. Bast leapt from his shoulder, dropping her disguise and picking up the still petrified Undri. "Get her out of here, Butifalis!" he shouted, and the nightmare ran over as the cat devil placed Undri on his back. "That's no familiar, and a nightmare to boot. Rather naughty, Julian. And playing with the dragon's blood too. If you weren't so insufferably holy, I could use you as an apprentice," Ilaghtham said almost approvingly. He looked out of the corner of his eye and noted Peregrine and the Ort were still moving. "How did you do that?" Ilaghtham said with a cruel grin. One of his hands changed into an all too familiar brass gauntlet with six glowing gemstones. "Oh yes," he said. He snapped. A bolt of lightning tore out of the sky and smashed the Ort and Peregrine into the dirt, leaving a small charred crater around them. They were breathing, but just barely. Senkit screamed in rage and laid into him with her mace, each attack erupting with golden flames. Ilaghtham smacked each one aside and then countered. Senkit raised her shield, but the magical halberd tore through it, her armor, and her arm like tissue paper. Julian winced as he saw Senkit's arm fall practically split in two, useless, to her side. Still, she was standing. He ran to heal Peregrine and the Ort before they expired and reached for his ritual book. Ilaghtham looked at Senkit in the way a butcher looks at a particularly fine slab of meat. "HM, you know, I think I'm starting to see why Andri looks at you that way. Anyone else would have died of shock from that blow. My mistress upholds me. In her name, even this is nothing." Senkit panted, her body weak, but her eyes brilliant with the fire of faith, a fire Ilaghtham would take great joy in extinguishing. She brought her mace forwards. The swing was completely unbalanced and predictable, but still deadly. Ilaghtham caught it. As the fires of Senkit's smite swirled around him, making him grimace from the pain, a different kind of fire swirled around them both. One that reeked of brimstone. Senkit tried to pull away, but too late, as Ilaghtham dragged both of them to hell. They re-emerged atop a canyon wall in a world where the horizon was on fire. The land was blasted, the orange rock covered in ashes. The sky was black with the smoke of war, and the land would have been dark if not for the blazing ruins and remnants all around them. All around them was the noise of war, loudest from within the canyon. There, the innumerable horrors of the abyss in all their endless forms clashed against the uniform line of brass-clad devils on the banks of a river black as midnight. It flowed smoothly, but the countless souls trying to keep their heads above water spread out streaks of white like rapids. At the center of the battle, a great Balrog, with flaming whip and lightning sword, fought desperately against the smaller figure. Her face was beautiful, even in this fog of war, and twisted by hatred. Her eyes, once golden, had turned to burning orange, and her fair skin was turned blood red. Her armor, once noble, had been cast aside for black iron. She no longer bore her shield, but instead a spear in one hand and a flaming sword in another. Her wings had turned to bone connected by a thin orange membrane, like a dragon's. Even still, Senkit knew from the depths of her soul who it was. Only she could have such skill, and even had it too been lacking, Senkit would have known. She had prayed to her so many times, hadn't she? She had held her image, the noble warrior clad in white with wings as bright as day, in her mind as the abject symbol of perfection, hadn't she? But the truth was undeniable. This was Zeriel, and she had fallen. Senkit fell to her knees, not wanting to believe but knowing for certain that it was true. This was indeed Amoness. She could tell that from the moment they had arrived, the place bolstered her wretched soul, for it was her home. She watched in horror as her idol tore the throat from the Balrog with her jaws, and led her forces forwards in savagery over his remains. Her heart was broken long before Ilaghtham drove his halberd through it. Julian was flung off his feet as the demigod returned, bringing the not-quite-dead Senkit with him. Julian took one look and knew what she had seen. His blood boiled, and he drew vengeful spirit and charged, only for Ilaghtham to knock him away, putting him through a half-broken pillar and onto the ground. Julian groaned as he recognized the now familiar feeling of his spine shattering. Ilaghtham left Senkit, halberd still sheathed in her, and stepped forwards, vanishing in a flash of light. He emerged in front of Bucephalus, who reared and struck down at him. The drow simply made a gesture, and the nightmare vanished. Ilaktham seized Dundry by the hair and dragged her back, teleporting back in front of Senkit and throwing her down. Dundry struggled to rise onto her elbows and stared in horror at her friend. Even when she had been on the brink of death, Senkit had never looked defeated. Now her eyes were downcast, the fire in them extinguished. Her mace hung limply in her hand. "What did you do to her?" she demanded, and Ilaktham shrugged. "Merely showed her a certain uncomfortable truth. I have a reputation as a liar, but that doesn't really fit. The truth is so much better to inflict pain with," he said as he walked over to the defeated paladin, stroking a finger along her tear-stained cheek. "I have a reputation for being cruel, but even I show mercy sometimes," he said. And before anyone could stop him, he seized Senkit's horns and twisted. The crack of a breaking neck echoed through the courtyard, followed by a scream of utter agony. "That is a sound I didn't realize you could make, and I've heard many of your screams. I think that just did more than all those demons ever did," Ilaktham said with a sort of macabre glee as he ripped his halberd free, casting aside Senkit's corpse like so much garbage. "Shoddy torturers, really. Flaying someone just trips flesh, no concept of how to flay apart a soul." Dundry finally rose, charging Ilaktham with her saber in one hand and dagger in the other. He swept aside the blades and tossed her to the ground bereft of them. He took a step forwards and then stopped. He heard the sound of chanting. He turned, and saw Julian laboring over Senkit's body, a diamond in one hand. Ilaktham stared in disbelief. "I shattered your spine, how could you?" Then he shook it off, and was about to laugh when he saw the Arsimer's eyes. They burned red with determination as he spoke the words of his spell. Julian had not been beaten. The paladins had not yet been beaten. For the first time, fear started to worm its way into Ilaktham's heart, but he trampled it down with ego. "Good. Bring her back, I broke her too quickly," he said mockingly, but Julian kept chanting. Ilaktham listened, and then realized that this was not a spell of resurrection. He flung out a hand and lightning ripped from it towards Julian, but too late. "Nine times I call. Nine times you are summoned. By blood and by my word, come forth, Zarathustra." The lightning stopped. Time stopped. For everyone except Julian, and the pit fiend standing beside him. "You cut it close. I expected you'd call me again," Zarathustra said as he helped the Arsimer to his feet, "though I'm afraid I can't take your soul as payment. It is already spoken for by our superior." "I haven't given it yet," Julian responded defiantly. "How much time is your daughter's life worth?" he asked. Zarathustra turned, and walked past the lightning and Ilaktham, and bent down. Julian could have sworn he saw a tear fall from the devil's face as he held the dead body of his little girl. "If I made the rules, a lifetime," the devil answered. "But I do not, perhaps a minute at most. That, or a teleportation spell." "What would I have to throw in to get both?" Julian asked. Zarathustra smiled, and looked at Vengeful Spirit. "Are you aware of how demon lords maintain their immortality, even upon their home plane?" Zarathustra asked. "They create amulets containing their essence." "I'm afraid I don't have one to trade," Julian answered. "No," Zarathustra responded. He looked at Vengeful Spirit. "Your band blade has been modified to absorb essences though. I shall imbue a portion of my spirit into it, granting myself true immortality." "What's the catch?" Julian said suspiciously. "It shall also grant your blade the ability to destroy mortal souls, so as to ensure the completion of this task I shall give you. It is entirely possible that I am unable to kill this demigod, or that destroying his mortal form shall simply banish him back to the abyss. I want you to make him suffer, as you annihilate every trace of him from existence," Zarathustra said with the calm anger that made even Julian shudder. "Gladly," he answered. Then, Zarathustra swore as he placed his hand around the blade of Vengeful Spirit. Blood flowed down both sides of the blade and coalesced into a brilliant ruby in the center of the crossguard. The inscription inscribed upon it changed. Now it read, I shall be a spirit of vengeance unto my enemies, an unerring eye of terror to seek them wherever they shall hide. We have a bargain, spoke Zarathustra, with words of power that bound him and Julian together by magic older and stronger than men. Julian, and the rest of the party, vanished, save Senkit's corpse. Zarathustra picked it up, closed his daughter's eyes, and kissed her gently on the forehead. Then she vanished as well. Then he turned to Ilaktham. Time flowed again. Ilaktham frowned at the lack of a Julian corpse, and then went flying. A mace struck him in the head with enough force to send him flying through the arch of the gateway and topple it. The shapeshifter completely lost his form, becoming a sort of yellow ooze that swiftly reconstituted itself. Ilaktham. A voice bellowed as the pit fiend leapt atop the rubble, hurling a fireball at the Archmage, who cast it aside. I am Zarathustra of the Iron Circle. Oh, really? The arrogant drow responded. Why should I care? You killed my little girl. Zarathustra responded, with the kind of low, total rage that only a father understands. Oh, so it's personal then. Good, the best fights always are.
Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.